Hello and welcome back to Grand Prix Barcelona 2017. I'm your host, Matej Bixizabalka, in the booth here with Raf Levy. And we got some feature matches ready for you, and they're almost about ready to start. But before we do that, let me apologize about what happened at the end of the previous round, where our program just crashed. We couldn't do much about it, but we recovered just in time for round six, and we can bring you some more live magic here. And the players are about to start right away, and we chose some particular matches here. We have David Inglis on the left from Great Britain against Aurelio Alueva on the right. And the matchup should be pretty interesting. Teamer Marvel, what does that do, Raf?
Teamer Marvel plans to gather some energy and tap Etherworks Marvels to bring Ulamog into play.
That sounds fun. I think we've seen a little bit of that over the last few rounds in this GP already. We'll see if there's going to be enough time for David English to set it up, because Aurelio is starting off fast with Tulkarf and Zempor, and then a Thraben Spectre, and already swings for three on turn two. Alright, what else does Aurelio have here? Does he have a fast start? I think I saw an Unlicensed Disintegration in his hand. But David English might be killing something off here, and there it is. Harness Lightning killing Tulkarf Exemplar, and potentially giving himself a lot more time here. Ooh, I see a Dynavolt Tower in David Inglis's hand. That's something that you don't really get to see a lot in these Marvel decks.
These days, the Teamer Marvel decks play four Etherworks Marvel and two Dynavolt Tower towers, just to make sure they have a way to use their energy.
Right. So there's a Wood Weaver's Puzzle Knot, gaining three energy and three life for David Inglis, who then plays a Mountain, one of his few basic lands that come into play on tap, because Aurelio Alueva did play a Thalia Heretic Cathar, which is swinging now at David alongside a Thraben Spectre. Let's see what turn four brings for Aurelio, who does have a Scrap Heap Scrounger, and not much else going on, but he has mana to sacrifice a clue if he wants to. Let's see, Boral's Expertise for David as well. His list seems interesting.
We're going to have a look at it, like, real soon. Oh, here we have it. Here we have it. The last turn, like, Aurelio could sense that David was short in lands, because playing the untapped Mountain was probably not the... Like, if he had the choice between different lands,
yeah,
playing the untapped basic Mountain, that'd have been the best choice.
Yeah.
So, four Marvel... Oh, he plays four Dynavolt Towers.
Four Towers?
Four Towers, four Marvels.
Wow, and two Boral's Expertise, and I think he drew both of them here. Now, the Expertise are not helping him that much, because he's facing off against so much pressure. Double Scrounger now from Aurelio there. And Aether Hub is going to enter the battlefield tapped, because he doesn't have any removal for the Thalia. And he's also going to be forced into playing maybe a tapped World of Virtuoso, and which I think he's just dead.
I think he's dead, yeah.
And
he can shoot one creature.
Yeah,
he can go down to now he's on 11. He can survive this turn, but that's
just not great setup for the following turn, where we know Aurelio does have an Unlicensed Integration in his hand as well. So if David ever plays a creature, Aurelio will probably just win. So I think so he's gonna play the tapped World of Virtuoso due to the Thalia. An attack will bring David down to one, but we know about the Unlicensed Integration, which is the last card, and that's the game. And not much to report here. Teamer Marvel got overrun by the Marvel Vehicles deck here.
It's a very unforgiving deck. If you stumble on lands, and that's probably why the deck does so well, because it's one of the only decks that really punishes you for not drawing the right cards. For example, black-green, that's probably why it kind of disappeared. It's because it's not as unforgiving. It's when you have the right draw, it's really fast, kills you very quickly with huge monsters. But sometimes, you know, you want to adapt with the other decks. If you play only creatures, you're going to lose to Saheeli.
Sure.
And you're probably not going to do well against the field.
Mm-hmm.
So you add some more control cards. And sometimes, you know, you just draw the control cards and you're not killing fast enough. And your opponent can recover from slow draws. So that's why, in this particular metagame, Mardu is doing so well. That's my analysis of why Mardu is doing so well. It's an unforgiving deck with very powerful cards that can turn into a control deck if needed.
Mm. We're going to have a look at the table two here between Kirill Patel and Bart Van Aten. We see a familiar story here. Mardu on both sides of the board. I do see Cultivator's Caravan, Heart of Kirin, and Scrappy's Scrounge on Kyura's side. And Pia and quite a bit of similar cards on the other side. And, with life totals of 14 and 10, this matchup can be pretty swingy. But fortunately for Kyura, he has two clues to get more cards and maybe steamroll this. Cultivator's Caravan looks pretty impressive on this board. Let's see if he can find something to follow. I also see an unlicensed disintegration with Bart only on 3 lands. This can turn sour very quickly. Let's see. Shambling Wind and Heart of Kirin in Kyura's hand there as well. He's trying to identify the best line of play here.
I think attacking with just a Scrounger is the play. Yep. Oh, no.
He's
well, that could be the play, too.
Yeah. Could be. Well, we'll see.
Yeah.
All right. So, yeah, as expected there, Bart crews his Heart of Kirin. There's an unlicensed disintegration. Yeah, Bart's just going to sacrifice it to Pia's ability so that he doesn't take 3 from the unlicensed disintegration. Another nice benefit of PNLR. And a chump block from Bart Van Aten just so he doesn't take any more damage. There's a Shambling Vent from Kyura who still has 2 mana up for the clue sacrifice. Let's see if Bart can turn around and another unlicensed disintegration of his own. That he's falling behind on the board really fast, and I think that's a big danger in these mirror matches.
Yeah, not having the fourth land is does not let Bart expand his board, and while Kyura is just battling threats and backing them up with removal.
And now here come the cards. And Avacyn drawn as the first card off of that clue, so it's gonna mean that Kyura should be pretty safe from any removal here. Plays the concealed courtyard, and now he can keep swinging. Would you say the importance of playing first or drawing first is very big, or is the advantage minimal?
What have I read not too long ago? I think there was stats about like Mardu on the play and Mardu on the draw.
Uh-huh.
I think it was like 75 on the play.
Really?
Something like incredible.
Ouch.
Yeah. Something like that. I don't exactly remember the numbers, but I think it was something super high.
Yeah, I think it ties in well with what you said before. Here you see Unlicensed Disintegration trying to kill the Colivius Caravan. Kirill Patel playing the Avacyn to protect the Caravan, and Bart Van Aten realized that, okay, there's no way I'm winning this now that there was an Avacyn in play as well. And so, Kirill Patel from Great Britain takes game one here, and we're going to go back to our original match soon enough. So, yeah, but the statistic you said, it ties in well with what you said before about how punishing of a deck it is, especially it must be amplified when the deck is also playing first.
And one of the big reasons for that, for these stats, that I believe the stats should be like this. I think it's probably 75% on the play, at least.
Yeah.
And Gideon plays a huge role in this because, well, Gideon on the play is hard to beat. Gideon on the draw... There are times when you won't be able to play it because there's too much pressure. There's a Heart of Kirin that you can't block because they're going to attack you. You're going to activate your own, and they're going to take it down.
Yeah. So we did say David Inglis is playing Team Marvel, but his sideboard is very interesting. 4 Green Belt Rampager, 4 Long Tusk Cubs. There's some Release the Gremlin, some Dispel, some Negates. He's basically turning his deck into an aggro machine, and he kicked it off right away with a Green Belt Rampager. But I believe he did mulligan at least to 6 because he doesn't have that many cards left in his hand. And now the Rampager is facing off against the Heart of Kirin. No attacks there. David English looked like he has passed the turn like 5 times. I still not untapping. There we go.
click F6 a couple times.
Is it lag?
Lag, test, lag test.
Yeah, and then you pass two of your turns and you're like, man, that's the worst. All right, let's see. Okay, unlicensed integration from Aurelio. Is there a negate? No, just a harness lightning on the Toolcraft exemplar to take it down before it can crew the Heart of Kirin. I think David would have killed that before combat anyway, but it doesn't take any damage here. I think David drew both, like two of his Ulamogs already.
Six lands to go.
Yeah. Well, he has one in his hand, and there's a Glimmer of Genius, so that can definitely help dig him further. Let's see what Aurelio can do here. I think I see Scrap Heap Scrounger, maybe Walking Ballista. So Scrounger first, crew, take four. And a Toolcraft Exemplar? No, a Walking Ballista for one. I wouldn't say this is the best card in this matchup. It seems fairly slow.
Yeah.
All right, green Puzzle Knot is kept. Or the land that was kept? Yeah, he kept the Puzzle Knot and drew an Aether Hub. So he's getting somewhere.
Is he?
I guess, like, at least he's staving off that for a little while, but...
Well, that doesn't... I don't think it helps that much.
Yeah. I didn't like the puzzle, keeping the puzzle out there.
No, it's not an active card.
Yeah. Just try to dig further. I mean, at least this...
I don't know what he'd do. Count. If he took out the... No, he has to have kept the Marvels.
Yeah.
Otherwise, he wouldn't have had the
Ulamogs,
two Ulamogs. Yeah. What did he cut for the creatures?
Maybe the towers, like Dynavolt towers.
Isn't tower very good against the...
I don't know. Depends on how you want to spend your energy. Ooh, look at that. Here's a Chandra. Pluses. It's a Scrappy Scrounger. So he won't be able to play that, so he just deals two to David. And then, using the Heart of Kirin crew, using a loyalty counter from Chandra and swinging for a lot of damage, 8 damage. So David English is taking... A lot of damage, though. It does get to sack the Puzzle Knot to go up to 9 and gain some more energy, but he needs a Marvel right about now. Doesn't draw it, just more lands. Just extend his hand.
That was a hell of a game.
Yes. That was very fast. And David's deck really didn't really impress that much, even though he was 5-0 off of, I believe, one or two buys there. So Aurelio Alueva already locking in the day two at 6-0 and possibly going for a much better result. I was expecting a little more from David's side of the board, but oh well, he'll have some countrymen maybe to take the torch for Team Great Britain, because this feature match area kind of looks like Rich Hagen's best selection. He chose some British guys to represent. One of them, Joao Chaussa, that you see on the left there, he went 9-0 in Grand Prix Utrecht, but couldn't convert into the top 8 ultimately, but fighting hard for it. But we also saw Kayur Patel. He's shuffling up there in the middle, and his opponent is Bart van Eten of the Netherlands. And you see Joao is already up a game there. And another interesting match in the back there. You can see Andrei Strasky, the Platinum Pro from the Czech Republic. He's facing off against Marcus Angelin of Sweden there. Also, all players are 5-0. So I think we're going to go look at the match between Kirill Patel and Bart van Eten. Maybe we can have a look at the sideboards of those players, if they have something interesting that we could talk about in their sideboard, because we've seen plenty of variations in those sideboard cards that you can bring in. We've seen the Mardu Ballistas deck bring Planeswalkers and Oath of Chandras, Oath of Liliana. So is there anything that you would consider interesting in the sideboards of these two players?
So let's see. In a Bart sideboard, so he has two Ballistas, two Release the Gremlins, one Fatal Push, two Shocks, one Sky Whaler's Shot, two Thalias, two Chandras, two Sky Sovereign, one Caravan.
Yeah.
Nothing really particular. He doesn't have the Oath package.
Yeah.
And Kayura has... He does have the... No, he only has Oath of Chandra. He doesn't have the Oath of Liliana, but he has two Chandras.
Mm-hmm.
Avacyn, Sky Sovereign.
Yeah, a couple of painful truths, like stuff that we've seen over the last few weeks pop up, but nothing really that exciting.
One painful truth. Yeah.
One. Yeah.
Not great in the mirror.
Yeah, let's have a look at the game though. He started Bart started off with a walking ballista on turn two, and then a Heart of Kirin on turn three. Not the most exciting of starts, but Kayur Patel hasn't really had much to do of his own. Just to release the gremlins on turn three, taking care of that Heart of Kirin and getting a gremlin of his own. I think it looks like Bart van Aden is struggling a little bit on red mana here.
He does have a spire.
He has a spire. All right, so he does have the mana. Has released the gremlins of his own. And a couple of other cards. I think one of them was a Scrap Heap Scrounge. So let's see what he can play here. Because Kayura had a fairly slow start, but he has Gideon, Thalia, Needle Spires in hand. Yeah, a couple of more lands. I think Shambling Venom playing as well, but at least he'll be able to play a Gideon on turn four if he wants to, which is always a pretty nice play. As Bart van Aden just plays a turn four, a Walking Ballista as a 2/2. Not that inspiring. Another release the gremlins for Kayur Patel. So
the question now is, do you play Gideon? Against two ballistas, probably not. But the thing is, he can probably wait a turn and play release the gremlins for two.
Yeah, but he needs to play it because he needs to play tapped land this turn, so he has the untapped land on turn five. So I think he can start with Thalia. Hopefully slow down Bard a little bit and then play a Needle Spires or Shambling Vent this turn. I think he's going to go for Needle Spires. No, he goes for the Shambling Vent. Proving me wrong there.
Yeah, if he draws a Chandra.
He might regret that.
Yeah.
Oh, we'll
see. If he has Chandra. He has two in the board. I don't know if he boarded them in. He boarded them in.
Okay.
Probably not, because it's not great against the Art of Kirin.
Right, so it looks like Bard has an inspiring advantage now alongside that release the gremlins. And I think a Thalia of his own. So let's see what he can figure out here. For him, having a lot of mana in this sort of matchup seems fine because you have Walking Ballista, so you can sink a lot of mana into that. But on this board, it doesn't look that enticing.
That's going to shoot the Thalia.
Yeah, very likely. Still is going to get to play released a top.
So now we can play. Now we can play Gideon.
Yeah, now it's much better.
And if Bart decides to keep his mana open to pump his walking ballistas, then he can. I'm not sure about attack though.
No, he's gonna go for the big release the gremlins.
Oh yeah, okay.
It's gonna fizzle out because Bart's just gonna shoot the gremlin with each walking boost. Isn't gonna get any gremlins because all the targets fizzled. But it keeps the board clear, and he can then play a Gideon on his next turn. I mean, I would prefer to see Gideon here, honestly. It felt better, a little better on this board, especially if he had kept the gremlin back. Not even attack
Gideon,
here.
Yeah, but Gideon would have died to Unlicensed Disintegration.
And I think that's what he's playing around.
I think that was a fine play.
Yeah, I think it's okay, ultimately. He's playing a little careful. We have the luxury of knowing cards in both players' hands, so, naturally it makes sense.
Did you see a Bart's face?
Yeah.
Was it the Navasin face?
It was a complete Navasin face.
No, I have nothing to play with five mana open.
Oh, poor me.
Gotcha.
Yeah, there it is.
Well, I didn't have it.
And look at that. Kayura actually didn't go for the Night Ally. Yeah. He plussed it immediately. This is a play that I haven't seen that many players doing, even though to me it seems like a lot of the time it's fairly obvious. In the face of Avacyn or Unlicensed Disintegration, sometimes you really should just plus the Gideon.
Yeah.
He has another one in his hand, but ultimately that was a very sweet play from Kayura Patel. Not getting the immediate value, but... potentially either forcing Bart to invest a lot of mana into attacking the Gideon with a Shambling Vent, or forcing him to not just play something on the board and not killing the Gideon. So, but he's going to go for it right away.
Yeah. But then you get no value from Gideon.
Yeah.
You don't even get the token. So, but he didn't know. Like, he wasn't 100% sure he had the the Avacyn. Well... There was a good chance Avacyn was
there. It was a very good chance there was an Avacyn. It was quite unlikely.
If you looked at Bart's face, it was a very, very good chance he had Avacyn.
Yeah, but I mean, these kind of mind games and what we call reads are sometimes very important.
I'll do that every time.
Yeah?
I will next time I don't have Avacyn, I'll do the same thing. No, have nothing. Wink, yeah. Wink.
Yeah, it's like, go.
Yeah, okay, I have 5 mana, go. Oh.
Yeah,
oh, man, another nothing. Oh, come on.
Okay, just an Aether Hub from Bard there, who faces off against the Weather Motorist. Both players with very healthy life totals there. Let's see. Release the Gremlins, Krabby Scrounger.
Oh, no, I have nothing again. Oh, yeah. Come on.
I just have removal. You know, I'm just going to play it on the Veteran Motors. Look at that. Kira Patel has Gideon, has Sky Sovereign. That's bold. Especially if you have no unlicensed integration. Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
Well, there's not much he can do. With his hand, there's nothing he can do against Avacyn.
Yeah.
And even if he plays the boat, that boat is not going to do much.
Yeah.
Especially since we know that Bart has released the Gremlins.
Mm. And Avacyn has been popping up a lot in the Smart Vehicles deck, and it's showing now why it's so important.
Yeah.
And one of the most, what we've seen in game one is like, okay, so unless in disintegration, your guy, nope, Avacyn. I'll play Gideon. Nope, Avacyn. It's a great card if you get the mana to cast it.
Inkari does not play Avacyn.
He has one in his sideboard.
Yeah, one in sideboard.
Non-main.
And Bard is playing... What is he playing?
He has two in the main deck.
Two main deck, yeah. So he has the two of them are here.
Yeah. Both drew both of them. Lucky Bard. Yeah, look at Kairi Patel not wanting to miss out on any value. He just plays Gideon and gets an emblem immediately. At least he'll get to put them to some use with his man lands, but it's not great. And now 4 mana.
Here comes
Gideon of his own. And Bard Fanate looking in the driver's seat here.
Yeah, the game is slipping away.
Yeah.
Quickly from Kair's hands.
Yeah, and it was a slow game to start. Like, both players didn't have that much to do. But then, once the big hitters kept coming, Avacyn looks like the best trump. Kair needs to draw something really nice here if he wants to win the game. Even the emblem making all his guys bigger might not help here. His Sky Sovereign, he can play that and kill something, but that will also mean that the Avacyn will get flipped and just mean it's going to spill game over even faster. All right, so Thraben Inspector, Sky Sovereign. Okay, he can ping the Gideon at least. But now I think Bard will finally get a chance to play his Release the Gremlin on the Sky Sovereign and on the Clue and swing in for heaps of damage that Kairi Patel will not be able to recover from. So we're going to get to see game 3 here. I mean, people tend to say that these Mardu mirror matches, oh, it's so boring, but I tend to find them really interesting.
There are a few decisions that are very very close to make. And attacking with the right creatures, playing around the right removal spells.
Yeah.
Takes a lot of practice as well.
Yeah, and also something really small such as sequencing your lands correctly, yep, depending on what you want to be doing and how you want to answer is the thing that's very key.
What happens when your opponent plays Thalias? Stuff like that.
Yeah, you have to decide the Thalias or even, Pias can be really important just the way they play out. So we'll see what that means. As you see, a lot of the other players, we actually have Joao Chaussa on the left there. He's facing off against Shota Takao of Japan, who also brought the black-red Kull's aggro deck that we talked about before. Certainly very exciting and innovation, and he's 5-0. Unfortunately, his countryman Toru Inoue did lose his round 3. In the feature match area, but I'm curious if the deck can keep performing. It looked very sweet. Just Eldrazi's with some black-red cards, Unlicensed Integration, and Ruins of Oran Reef doing a lot of work. So we might see more of that deck sooner or later. But we'll get to look at the feature match that we moved to our main seed here. It's Andrei Strasky on a Saheeli Copycat facing off against Marcus Anglin. Both players at 1-1, and I think we'll see a lot more of this matchup as the weekend develops. This is what we consider probably the two best decks in the format. Would you agree?
when so many tournaments have been playing the same format and that the same decks constantly come out on top, you can't be a little certain that it's what's going to happen next. Like, unless something unreal happens, like there was an underdog, like something under the radar for so long and no one discovered, then that would be a surprise. But with so many tournaments, we can assume that it's going to be the main match of the tournament.
Yeah. There's going to be some variation, of course. We're talking about Mardu Vehicles and Mardu Ballista as slight differences in those decks. And, you know, we saw Archangel Avacyn in this one, and some players already packed the Sky Sovereign. Like, there's a lot of different cards that can be seen. But ultimately, it's going to be the same core cards. And now we see a Natural State taking care of the Heart of Kirin.
Like, there's just so many cards you can actually, like, use to change your version of the deck.
Mm.
At some point, like, everyone has found all the techs. And this is, like, this standard is very mature.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's been played many times. So, there are a few new things, but not...
Yeah, it has developed, but it's been slower and also much condensed. Like, people have been talking about some fringe decks, but they have petered away as, like, the other decks became more and more entrenched in the standard format, and those decks started, like, doing really well against each other, like, by innovating slightly. And we still see some innovation, but it's only within the established archetype, because just their power level is so high.
Yeah.
Look at that Tamiyo in Andrei Strasky's hand. Not the best when you have a lot of mountains in play or red sources.
I can still cast it.
Yeah, with Oath of Phinissa.
Oh, no, it was a Nether Hub.
Oh, he drew an Aether Hub? Okay.
No, he had Nether Hub.
Oh, nice. He even has a Plains.
Oh, yeah, well.
Right, so there's a Tamiyo. All right. Taps the Thraben Inspector and the Heart of Kirin. Protect itself. Gains Andre some time, because as you see, his big plan is ultimately is going to be the Sky Sovereign that he has in his hand. Alright, this one will take a while. So we're gonna go to our original match between Kiri Patel and Bart Van Aten. Look at which, if it holds true that the Mardu deck on the play has such a big advantage. So turn one Thraben Inspector, not much else from Kiri for now, who also has some decent card in his hand, but Bart's turn two Scrap Heap Scrounger certainly the better play here.
So no draw.
Kira didn't sacrifice his clue.
That's interesting.
I mean,
I think having the extra card is more important than to have the artifact here.
Yeah.
Because, like, he doesn't have the Spire of Industry, which that's usually the reason why you keep your clue on the board. If you don't have the black mana or the red mana, you keep the clue around. But if it's just to take advantage of the unlicensed disintegration, instead of looking for your fourth land, I think it's a little greedy.
It is, because now when he decided to play Thalia, he cannot sack the clue to dig for the fourth land, right? And you said yourself, Gideon on turn four is so important. Look at that.
Is he attacking?
Yeah.
I see.
You see why? Okay, explain to our viewers why you would attack into a Thalia with first strike with a Scrabby Scrounger.
I think I would have blocked.
Yeah?
Yeah. Because the only reason is that he has a Fatal Push. But then I still block.
Yeah. Yeah, Fatal Push, which I think Bard would have then used to kill off the Thalia.
Yeah.
And then play an untapped land and play the Scrounger anyway. Right, so, but now that means that Thalia is going to survive and Bard could play a tapped land and tap Scrap Heap Scrounger, just further developing his board. And as we talked about, Kiri Patel doesn't have the fourth land to play Gideon now, so he's going to just have to satisfy himself with release the gremlins on a Scrap Heap Scrounger, getting that gremlin token and passing the turn here.
Just hoping to draw a land. I don't know. I'm not a big fan of that line.
Yeah, now an untapped land for Bard. He found the basic and basic planes.
But, like, Bard now has a clue, so he can sack the clue to enable the revolt.
Yeah.
And then play Fatal Push. So there's no... Well, there was an incentive not to attack with Thalia.
Yeah, definitely. But as it stands, the players are racing away. Alright, there's the planes. So what will Barfanaden do here? He's gonna go for the PNLR, get a tap Thopter, and pass the turn still. Now he's leaving up the black mana for a potential Fatal Push.
Another disintegration.
Yeah, and still just three lands for Kiru Patel. He has a lot of good cards in his hand, but the question is, will he be able to deploy all of them?
Now, Gideon is not great.
Hmm. Especially when you don't have a fourth land.
No, but even if he does, then it would be actually okay. Now, I don't know.
I mean, you could get a emblem and start swinging.
It's true. So what's the plan here? I think there are a few lines you can take. You can do that.
Okay, he's just swinging, aggressive. Yeah. Yeah, so now look at that. Bard chump blocks with the Thalia, takes three here, but this will enable the revolt so that at the end of turn, he'll be able to kill off the Thalia. And it looks like Kayura kind of expected it already. Yeah, I think he might have had a read. And there's the Unlicensed Disintegration, killing off the P and the Lar. Clearing out the board a little bit here over the last two turns.
That was a tough turn for Kayura because he could have. There was another line that I was actually not too bad. Was to sack the clue with Plains and Courtyard, hoping to draw and then tap White Source, and then play the Motorist. Like, you will need to draw land eventually.
Yeah.
And, my line would have been pretty good.
Yeah? I think so,
It's much easier when you see that they draw land, but...
Yeah, of course.
If you do that, and... You're still racing, but that's... And then you lose the clue. That's what you have to keep in mind. But you'll find another artifact.
Right. So there's the Gideon. He's going to get a Night Ally. But it's still going to be tough for Kayura to hold the board here because I think Bard can bring back a Scrap Heap Scrounger at the end of the turn. Because he has other creatures in his graveyard. There's a Pia and a Thraven Inspector as well. And he does have an Unlicensed Disintegration in hand as well. So I think Bard is now like doing the math of what he can do. He's definitely going to bring the Scrounger back, that's for sure. But he has to decide what he wants to attack and how. He can definitely kill the Gideon just by playing the Unlicensed Disintegration or attacking the Gideon with the Thopter. Doesn't have much else going on, though. Drew another land here. All right, there's still two Scroungers as well as a Cultivator's Caravan. Threats are big. All right. So this is going... it looks like the Scrappy Scroungers are going towards the face, it looks like.
The face. I like that.
Yeah?
The face, yeah.
Yeah, the face. Going for face is always
face,
good.
Yeah.
You know, it's like kind of like when you have five mountains untapped and the full grip. Like, what's your life total? Here's the burn spells to your face.
So the reason why he's not attacking with the Cultivator Caravan is because Kayura is probably going to block one of the Scrap Heap Scrounger.
Yeah, at least.
And
okay, it looks like they're trading away everything.
And then he's going to bring one back, and he'll be able to block with a caravan.
Yeah.
That's the plan.
It's still...
That was his plan.
Okay, sure.
I'm not saying it's good. I'm not saying it's bad. That's the reason why.
What would you have done?
I don't know. I'm not sure because I didn't count fast enough.
Yeah.
But maybe attack with a caravan instead of
sure.
one of those.
Yeah, I would have liked to attack. I would have liked to see an attack with a caravan.
To the face.
To the face, indeed.
That's always better.
Yeah, because there were just no really good blocks for Kayur Patel there. Even a triple block would have then put him in the world of hurt because of the Unlicensed Disintegration. Exactly. So, all right. So three mana. So now he's going to disintegrate the Thraven Inspector. Yeah.
release the Gremlins here from Kaior's side would be
insane.
Pretty insane, yeah.
Yeah.
That face someone who drew a. No.
Doesn't look like he. I think he found another land there. He has Veteran Mortars, but he's gonna go for the Gideon. Drew a Concealed Courtyard.
It's actually pretty good.
Yeah. It's kind of nice. I mean, he'll still is gonna be the Scrappy Scrounger.
Yep.
One more left in the graveyard. Just need some more fodder. Okay, Barfrey. This draw can be very important here. Okay, just the Spire of Industry, though.
This is another draw.
Yeah.
But the...
Okay, redraw.
A redraw. Yeah, rebuy.
Rebuy.
So, Thraven Inspector, pay two to sacrifice another land from Bart Van Aten. Not what he wanted to see here.
Now this game is kind of close. It's much closer. Like, the advantage bar doesn't know where to go now.
Yeah. Would have been all over the place here in this game because...
Well, it would have been on Bart's side for a long time, but now it's back on the...
Yeah, I didn't like Bart's play the previous turn. I didn't like using Unlicensed Disintegration to kill a Thraven Inspector.
Yeah.
I would like to see them use on one of the two power creatures because that would mean that Bart still would have had a Scrounger in play.
And he would have had to chump block.
Yeah.
Kiru's that had to chump block, so yeah.
Yeah.
Didn't quite like last turn.
Mm. Right, so there's now...
It's going to be a chump.
Chump block the Cultivator's Caravan with a Night Ally. Take one from the Thopter. Passing the turn here, and Kiru Patel, if he draws some action here, just an inspiring advantage of his own. He still has a Veteran Motorist, and still a clue in play as well. So, plenty of things to do. I'll kick it off with the Veteran Motorist here. Shock and a land. Well, the land is going to hit the bottom of the library.
Probably shock as well.
Very likely. It's not doing much on this board.
No.
And unless Disintegration is good. Now he finally has time to fire it off. All right, I think now Bart will be much more careful now that Kaior finally found a way to have untapped mana available with the Gideon already in play. I can just see if Bart draws an Iveson here. Game can again swing very fast here. Oof, just a Shambling Land though. At least it's a land, but it's at least a land that can become a creature.
Yeah, that turn was crucial. The caravan turn was very crucial. Because now you can see he could have put Kaior down to like three or four life.
Yeah.
And now he would still have the Thopter.
Yeah.
And Thopter would have done a lot of work. He would have Kaior would have needed to use his disintegration on the Thopter.
Mm.
Leaving a lot of stuff out.
Yeah, plenty of lands for Bart Van Aten. Adds another one and Shambling Vent to his board. Now a big draw for Kiru Patel.
And that's also a big tell from Kaior's not sacrificing the clue end of turn.
Mm-hmm.
That's a big warning. That's a big red flag.
Yeah.
Oh, what could I have?
It's fairly obvious at this point. I think Bart recognized it as well. Kaior left up 3 mana the previous turn. Left the clue now.
Like, as we said, it's not sure you have it.
Yeah, of course.
But now it's like, when you were not sure, like 75%, now it's up to like 90 or 95.
Yeah, definitely. But now Kaior is starting to run away with the game. Gideon activation turn after turn really put the screw on Bart Van Aten, who just doesn't have any relevant spells here just yet. He can bring back a Scrounger by exiling the other one. Some cannibalism going on here. And slowly but surely, another Plains. Jeez. Both players with a ton of lands there and not drawing any of those big haymakers. And Bart must recognize here that unless Disintegration is something that is very, very likely to be in Kaior's hands.
Isn't Bart dead like very soon?
I think so, yeah. It's not going to take long. going face with that Thopter token. Plays another land.
Still not drawing a card. Another Inspector. It's like the best card you can actually draw.
Yeah, it's like it's a creature, it's a blocker. It also draws you a card eventually. Okay, Fatal Push. And Kyur Patel. Just more removal spells.
Oh, no, it's not gay because he has Shambling Vent. Otherwise...
It would have been really close to game. Yeah, that should tick up now.
Yeah. Five.
Just big swing from Gideon here. 5-5. Yeah, and just the chump block from Bart. The game slowly slipping away from Bart Van Aten. Needs a big card here. Okay, unlicensed integration. Maybe a little too late. Because Kyrie already has set up his defenses so well. Look at that. Kyrie has had enough of that top token. Goes for the fatal push. Yeah, and I think Bart is really struggling here now. Remember, Scrappy Scrounger cannot block, and the Cultivator's Caravan can bite the dust very soon with that unlicensed integration if it ever gets screwed. And I think Kyur can attack with everything here. I mean, there's still the Shambling Vent, of course. You shouldn't forget about that one. But so that's why Kyur plays a little slow here.
I think he's playing around Avacyn.
Yeah, he has to be careful. I mean, he saw two in one of the previous games, so he has to recognize that that's a risk. And look at that. Bart Van Aten is taking all of the five damage. Goes down to six, now passes the turn back to Bart Van Aten.
Like, here playing a land is a little... another license integration.
And this would have been lethal if the Thopter got through for one more point of damage. That was a very timely fatal push from Kyrie Patel on one of the previous turns. Now Bart with two... unlicensed disintegration in his hand.
Actually pretty good.
Yeah.
Oh, no, like, Curious has the disintegration in hand, too.
Yeah.
That's too bad, because that would have been really good.
Yeah, I mean, you don't seven, not six, because the two disintegration. Just insane amount, right? There's 10 lands total, I think. So that's the 11th land.
No, but, like, that's relevant for the actual play.
Yeah, sure. Oh, he has 10 lands now in play.
All right, so what happens if he attacks with the Shambling Vent and the Caravan? I don't like that. I wanted to kill the Gideon right away.
Yeah.
Because now he's just dead.
Yeah. I think he's just homing in too much on, like, maybe trying to draw something to survive this turn while also being able to...
There's no way he can attack for one.
Yeah. So that's the thing. Okay, there's this big swing with everything. And now he knows that, Kyur knows that Bart has to animate the Shambling Vent to create an additional blocker.
Yeah.
And Kyur is going to take advantage of that and kill it. You can see, like, Kyur Patel all this time has the clue in play. He hasn't sacked it. Bart has to know that there's an unlicensed integration.
Yeah. Like, it hasn't just disappeared from Kyur's hand. Like, he knew he had it the whole time.
Yeah.
He had to do something.
Yeah, so crew. Cultivator's Caravan. Like, yeah, okay. Okay, we're getting to blockers.
That's good.
Good for Bart.
Where
is it?
What do you block?
Oh, you have to block the Gideon, right?
You have to block the Gideon. Probably with the...
The Shambling Vent, and then try to use the Cultivator's Caravan to eat the Veteran Motorist, kill the Knight Ally token.
I think what's going to happen...
Mm-hmm. Tell me. I want to know.
Like, there's a chance that he shocks his own... Oh, no, it doesn't do anything. Never mind. No. There was that I was looking for a smart way out. That doesn't work.
Yeah, you tried to be too cute there, so we'll see. Yeah, so Shambling Vent blocking the Gideon... And now, Bart's like, okay. The 4 damage, though. He's going to unlicense and integrate the Nihil. Look at that. Kyrie Patel also drew a shock.
So now he can shock the... Oh, no. This, he can see if he shocks the crown... does it work? The Scrounger... No, it doesn't work.
No.
Oh, this game is great.
Yeah, it is. It's really close. I still don't like the way either play has made in some of the turns. But it's still, there's a lot of decisions to still be made here. So, yeah.
So what do you do here? So Bard's on six. I think I killed the Shambling Vent here.
Yeah.
I think I would have killed the Shambling Vent before blockers.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure. I would have done that as well, but I'm trying to find a way of how to make sense of this after blocks have already happened. All right, so he's going to just gonna resolve everything.
Now we can actually lose this game.
Yeah, so he's going to gain 2 life, lose 2 life, though. So I think Bard's still at 6.
Yeah. Why?
Yeah, this is one short off of winning with Shock and Unlicensed Disintegration.
If he played Disintegration, he would have won right away.
Yeah. So, okay, so now he disintegrates the Cultivator's Caravan after blockers. Right. And that's going to spring Bard into action. This game's weird.
This game's very weird.
Yeah. Right, get some mana. Bard can now.
No, he's on what?
Okay.
Okay. He took 1 more damage.
Oh yeah, yeah. We probably missed somewhere along the lines because the life totals weren't updated that fast. So yeah, that confused us as well. But it made sure that Kiryu Patel has actually won the game because Bard van Aten was very low on life indeed, and so the Shock finished off the game alongside the Unlicensed Disintegration. And yeah, there you have it. That was round 6 here at GP Barcelona, and.
Yeah, that's a good point. Gideon prevents damage, so the lifelink
didn't happen. Yeah, we missed that. Yeah, it was an interesting line, and that's why I think Kair was happy with the play, even though we both would have played it slightly differently, but it worked out very well. Thanks, chat, for helping us out. And that's it from round 6 at GP Barcelona.